Thank you, Skip. I appreciate the invitation and the opportunity to share with you today on exploring the Bible with contemporary youth. And our primary goal will be to talk a little bit about creative ways that we can engage youth in the Bible. One of the things that I always do, those of you who've had me in class, is we always begin with some kind of an opening meditation, and hopefully we'll have time at the end to close with a closing meditation. And what I'd like you to do is to, if you see those little plates on the table there with a snack on them, I'd like for you to pick one that maybe is your favorite or one that you like, one that you're interested in, and just hold it for just a minute and keep the plate close by as well because you'll be using that plate. But because we are talking about creative ways of engaging youth in the Bible, with the Bible, I thought we might start with a creative way of doing our opening meditation. So I've invited my colleague, Dr. Lucinda Huffaker, who is the Director of Supervised Ministry and also the Executive Secretary of the Religious Education Association, to read the scripture for us. And the scripture comes from Psalm 34, verses 1 through 8. And I'd like for you just to listen to the words, and then I'll give you some more direction with what to do in just a few minutes.
Psalm 34. A psalm of David. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear it and rejoice. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. They looked to him and were radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and rescues them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. How blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. How blessed is the man who takes refuge in him.
We want to invite our youth to taste and see that the Lord is good. And one of the ways that they do that is to learn to delve into the Bible in a way that has meaning and power and transformation in their lives for them. So what I'd like for you to do now is to take that little treat, and I want you to look at it, analyze it, think about it. You can smell it if you want to. And if you're so tempted, you can put it in your mouth and just taste it. See what it feels like on your tongue. If it's salty, how does the salt roll in your tongue? If it's sweet, how does that sweetness burst in your mouth? What does it feel like as you're chewing it? Taste and see that little treat is good. Now what I'd like you to do as you continue to meditate on the scripture, taste and see that the Lord is good. And as you're thinking about that treat that you've just put in your mouth and you're meditating on, I want you to take your plate and write a prayer to the Lord. And that treat is the central focus of your prayer. For example, I'll read one that I did a long time ago. I had a pretzel at that time. Gracious God, you are so faithful to me. I am all twisted up with the savory, salty pleasure of your goodness. I stretch and bend in all directions as the savory pretzel allows me to give praise and honor to your name. So use that treat as the central focus for your prayer and write it on your plate. And I'm going to give you just a minute or two to do that. And then I'm going to invite you to share around the table your prayers. Talk about what your treat was, and then share the prayer that you wrote with one another. We have about a couple minutes to do that. I'd like to bring you all back to the circle, to the larger group now. What did you notice about your prayers? Would anyone like to share from your table or from the person that you shared with? Okay. A fun way to pray. Okay. Good. Anyone else have any thoughts about the experience? Or if you'd like to share your prayer with us. Pardon? Stealing the experience. Stealing the, okay. All right. Good. You're stealing it right away. Anyone else? Any idea? Any thoughts? Or? To grab their attention and to do, absolutely. And putting out their favorite snacks also, you know, helps the sugar high and the salty crash. So, okay, good, very good, yes. Any other thoughts on the prayer? So taste and see that the Lord is good. And that's one way that we can invite our youth into the Psalms and into a time of prayer that can be easy, quick, fun, and accessible. Our purpose today is simply to talk about creative ways of engaging youth. And we know that there are so many things in this world that capture our youth's attention. And unfortunately, you can't see the PowerPoint slide there. But in a technological world, our youth are caught up with so many of the social media and the technology, from Facebook to Twitter to Tumblr to Pinterest to Instagram, Flickr. All of these things are different ways that youth capture, use their time and their energy, and they're focused on all of these different aspects of our technological world. And so what we want to do is not put these items down. Maybe there's a way that we can use them as we teach the Bible, but add another layer of information in terms of how we might be able to teach the Bible. So how can today's youth find time to explore the Bible? And that's what our purpose is today, to explore, oh boy, not a good choice of slides. to explore ways of teaching the Bible with today's youth. And I wanted to talk just very briefly about the nature of youth, and then delve into two or three creative approaches, and then talk a little bit about equipping youth to engage the Bible. So the nature of youth. One of the things that we want to keep in mind, that as teachers and youth leaders and directors of religious education, in order to teach youth effectively, we have to make sure that we understand them on every level of their development. In other words, we need to have a holistic understanding of our youth, understanding them in terms of their physical, mental, social, emotional, and spiritual characteristics. And we must also consider what their spiritual needs are, and what does that mean for us with regards to Christian education and teaching the Bible. So the questions that we might ask as we think about teaching our youth and being effective in teaching them is, who am I teaching? Where are they physically, mentally, socially, emotionally, and spiritually? And what are their needs? How can I address their needs appropriately at their age level, and what does this mean in terms of how I engage youth in teaching the Bible? And so, if you've done any work on developmental issues, developmental stages, stages of faith, some of the foundational research that has been done, and I'm not going to go through all of this, but some of the foundational scholars who have gone on before and done significant research that will contribute to this presentation, John Piaget, Jean Piaget, who has focused on cognitive development, Eric Erickson, who has looked at the psychosocial development of youth, Lawrence Kohlberg, who has looked at the moral development, Carolyn Gilligan, with her groundbreaking work at the time, focusing on relationships and how women develop and how women engage with one another and the world, James Fowler with his faith development, and then Mary Wilcox and Ed Everding focusing on life stages of development. So when we think about youth, the nature of youth, and their development and their growth, and the various phases that they go through, it's important for us to remember that they go through growth spurts and go through these different stages of development at different times. And you probably have already noticed that you'll have some youth who are very, very mature in the group and have another one that is the same age and may not necessarily be quite as mature. And so they go through these stages at various times in their lives and in their development. And also when we think in terms of these different aspects of growth and development, that these are not rigid, hard, and fast categories that we put our youth into, but they are simply representatives. They are simply ways for us to understand where they are and that they are moving in and out of these different stages. And also, we cannot define people by these categories. It's important to keep that in mind. So I'm going to just quickly say one or two things about the different characteristics of the junior high age and the senior high age. Junior high ages 12 through 14, if we're looking at their physical characteristics, now putting this in a nutshell is really hard, but I'm only going to try to name one or two things. First of all, they're going through a tremendous amount of growth at this point in time, and so they can be awkward. They can be a little bit restless because of that. Their sexual organs are beginning to develop. Their arms and legs are getting lanky and long, and they're trying to figure out who they are in this new body. In terms of their mental characteristics, they can be imaginative, very creative. They daydream a lot, but they also are very teachable. They're open to learning and to hearing new ideas. Their social characteristics, they're sensitive to criticism, they crave acceptance. This age group tends to formulate around groups and gangs. They find their identity with their group of friends. The girls are coming to school in the same clothes, and the boys are, you know, hanging out in the same tennis shoes and things of that nature. So they crave acceptance at this time. Emotional characteristics, intense and moody, rebellious. Oh boy, do we remember that stage in life. And then their spiritual characteristics, which is important for us to remember if we're talking about teaching the Bible. It's a time of awakening, although during this time of awakening, they have many doubts, many fears, and not necessarily sure about this religion thing. But they're eager to serve, and they also have a kind of tendency to have icons, heroes that they look up to and they admire. So what would the needs then be if we're going to be teaching this age group the Bible? They want to feel wanted and respected, to see consistency in their teachers, guidance and assurance of love, physical and mental stimulation, and to recognize the importance of their spiritual lives. So what does that mean if we're teaching the Bible for this age group? Keep in mind that class participation and activities are important, that we need to try to have as many activities as we can throughout the lesson, so that they don't get bored, but that we keep them up and moving. That we offer Bible study, that we invite them to participate in a daily devotion, that we invite them to pray, even if it's as simple as writing a prayer about their favorite snack. But it's a prayer, and it's an opportunity to practice that. Provide opportunities for them to serve and then present Christ. And then the last implication would be activities to help build self-esteem. In terms of the senior highs, 15 to 18-year-olds, their physical characteristics, and again, this is a very, very tiny little nutshell, but they are at a place now where their growth is beginning to steady out, but yet there is decreased in activity. You may notice that senior high schoolers spend a lot of time sleeping. And the research is starting to bear that out, that they need more sleep. And schools are starting to change their beginning times to accommodate them so that they will be much more alert during the class time. And they're almost mature sexually. Things are happening, the hormones are flying, and they're adjusting to that. And this is the time when they find themselves attracted to others, whether it be of the same sex or the opposite sex. Mental characteristics, How many of you know teenagers who were very critical, but yet creative? Creative thinking. If you ask them to create something, especially if something that they have a lot of energy around, it's amazing how creative they are. And they do like to argue. So get them involved in some kind of a debate. That might be a good way to keep them busy. With regards to their social characteristics, peer pressure is a very important part of growing up, especially during this time period. And they're beginning to date seriously and to engage with others. But yet, even though they spend time with others, they're beginning now to establish a sense of independence. Their emotional characteristics, they feel misunderstood and they're easily disillusioned. And so one of our goals is to try very hard to understand, to listen, and to invite them into conversation. Their emotions are very intense at this time, although oftentimes they try to repress them. They're sentimental, they're, you know, gullible. Everything is wonderful or everything is horrible. It just depends on the day and the mood. And then their spiritual characteristics. Oops. At this stage, we're finding that many of our young people are beginning to They're beginning to have a lack of interest in the church and also a lack of respect for authority. And so how can we invite them to have a deeper sense of understanding and a deeper desire to be involved in church, or at least to be involved in a sense of spiritual development? And they have a desire to have understanding. So, the needs. They need leaders that they can trust and admire. And it's nice to be able to hang out and to be buddies, but yet, as leaders, we also need to be of the authority. We need to be not the kid, but the one who is responsible for reaching out and supporting the young people. They need understanding, they need guidance in dating, guidance in choosing college or vocation, and guidance in having, skip that last one. I apologize, I moved a little too fast. Guidance in vocation, I believe, was the last one. So what are the implications for Bible study? Good role models and examples, opportunities for service and leadership. We want to make sure that we give honest answers, because they will know if they ask us a question, a hard question, and we don't answer truthfully, then that sends a signal that maybe this person is not to be trusted. The implications are that we listen and we listen even more, listen more closely. And we offer Bible study, prayer, and personal faith development. That's how they grow. That's how they learn and to begin to engage the Bible. So other concerns. Thinking about aspects of race, ethnicity, disability, sexual orientation, one's heritage, family background, and others that influence their development. So, understanding our adolescence, and this comes from the textbook, Starting Right. This is a time of individuation, a time where they're trying to establish their sense of independence and identity. And so there are three tasks that they're trying to accomplish during this time. They're trying to establish a sense of identity. Who am I? They're trying to establish a sense of autonomy. Do I matter as an individual and a person in this world? And then they are trying to reconnect with others. And how do I relate with them? I'm going to skip this part. I'm going to just kind of go through it very quickly because I want to make sure that we have time to practice some of the creative approaches. But another part of the nature of young people that we need to be aware of is the fact that we all learn in different ways. And Karen Tai, in her book, Basics of Christian Education, basically talks about learning styles and that all of us engage the world, we perceive the world, we make meaning of the world in different ways. And while we are influenced by things around us in the world, many of us tend to have a particular preference. And so our learning styles, or the way that we learn, can be impacted by our heritage, by our personality, by our experiences, the situations that we find ourselves in, the schools that we're in. All of those things impact the way that we learn, the way that we perceive, and the way that we engage in the process of learning. So if there's one thing I want you to remember, there's more than one way to learn, and that we must be sensitive to the various styles, the various ways that people learn. So many of us in this room are probably familiar already with the three kind of general styles that we hear. People are visual, they learn by seeing, by reading, by looking at pictures, by looking at charts. Others are auditory. They have to hear it first. I happen to be an auditory learner. And I remember when I first got my new car, my father said, well, just sit down and read through the owner's manual. And I thought, yikes, I'll never figure out all the ins and outs of the car, because I needed to hear him kind of walk me through it in order to then sit down and read the directions. And then we have the kinesthetic learners. These are the ones that like to do things. They jump up, they bounce around, they like to touch and feel and taste, smell. These are the kinesthetic learners. Did you notice that when you all sat down, I invited you all to look through some of the magazines and to develop a collage and to look for some of the images that might represent today's youth? That was to engage the kinesthetic learners, the visual learners as well, but also then to give you an opportunity to think about, who is it that we are talking about, that we are working with? What do they look like? What are their concerns? What are their issues? I'd like to take a moment now and invite you, if anyone would like to share, what were some of the images that you found as you were flipping through the magazines that might represent today's youth, or the culture, and for the culture that they, in which they live? Yes. Exactly. Very good. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, that's exactly right. And sometimes our girls and even our young boys are looking at these images thinking, I don't look like that. Something must be wrong with me. And they find themselves trying to change in order to fit those images. Yes. Very good. We'll take one more and then we'll move on if someone would like to share. Yes. Oh, yes, yes, right, very good, yes. Now, I'm sure these are probably not the normal kids that we see, because these pictures have been touched up and cleaned up and presented in a way that puts the best foot forward oftentimes. But our kids are exposed to these things. And so this is a part of their world, it's a part of their culture, it's a part of youth culture, and they impact them in the things that they do. The Multiple Intelligences by Howard Gardner, who was responsible for creating the book Frames of Mind, And he talks about the fact that all children are intelligent. Everyone is intelligent. They're just intelligent in different ways. And unfortunately, the standardized tests only measure one or two of the different intelligences, such as the language, linguistics, and mathematics, logic mathematics. But what happens to the young person who's gifted musically, or the one who's a social learner, or the one who is a kinesthetic learner? So he basically says that we're all intelligent, but we're intelligent in different ways. He started off with 7 intelligences, and now there are 9, and everyone tends to favor one or more of these intelligences, although we do implement all of them at some point in our lives. And when we acknowledge these intelligences and the learning styles and we try to address them, that's why it's important to be creative in our teaching of the Bible. We then inspire a more dynamic and creative teaching experience. I have a handout with the learning styles on there, so, and the multiple intelligences, so I will pass that out and not actually go through this. When we're talking about creative approaches, we want to make sure that we want to do things that engage young people and invite them to go deeper into the Word. But we don't want to forget about the text, which is what we are trying to introduce them to, the context of the text, as well as our context, as well as elements of interpretation, so that we try to touch upon all of these, even in the activities that we do, even in the teaching that we do, so that they don't lose sight of the Word, and in their interpretation, that they understand that it's not just trying to make meaning, but also, what does that mean now in terms of what I should do with my life? There are some benefits to creative approaches to teaching the Bible, and one of the handouts that I will give to you is a pyramid, just like this one that you see. And if you look at the top, it says verbal, and that's like what I'm doing right now. I'm talking to you, and you've been talking back to me. So we've just been engaged in some verbal learning. And we only remember 10% of what we hear. So think about how you teach youth. Are you doing a lot of talking? Because they only remember 10% of what you hear. But if you add verbal and visual, notice that the pyramid gets wider. Now we're picking up 60%. You remember 60% of what you hear. So with the verbal, we add something visual. We add something for them to read. And then the more we get to the actual simulation or actual experience, we now remember 90% of what we hear and learn. So that's why we want to involve our youth. So we have a few more. What was that noise? Was my phone ringing? I have it here so I can watch my time. I want to invite us now to experience a different way of engaging the text. And these are just some ideas. There are tons of different things that you can do, and I picked out 10 of them, but we're not going to get through all 10 of them. But I want to at least try to get through one, maybe two, today. One is creating a psalm, and I have a handout that I can give to you all so that you can see what that process is. Inviting, maybe you can have a series where you're teaching about the psalms, and at the end of that series, invite your youth to create a psalm. And I had a copy of a beautiful psalm that my nephew wrote when he was in high school doing this very activity. Hearing and retelling the biblical story. This is where you invite young people to hear the story over and over and over again, but then invite them to retell the story. This is the one that we're going to actually do. And then there's one called A Penny for Your Thoughts. And I had a big old can of pennies that I was going to bring, and I ran off and forgot it. So I thought I would bring some candy instead, use the candy instead. And this is where you invite young people to read a very short passage of scripture. And then you might say, Donna, a penny for your thought. And then I would invite you, what do you think about that scripture? And then you would talk until you finish, and then you would invite someone else, a penny for your thoughts. And if they can add something to the interpretation and understanding of the text, they get a penny. And then the biography or timeline of a biblical personality, where you invite the young people to look at a biblical character, such as David, and do a biography. Read his story. If you're going to retell his story, how would you do it? And if we have time, I've got some butcher paper that we can roll out and create a timeline for one of the biblical characters. And then the last one in this section is biblical themes on in contemporary music, where we can look at hip-hop, Christian music, contemporary music, all of these different types of genres. We can look at secular music, gospel music, and then look at what are some of the biblical themes that might invite us to go deeper into the text. So I wanted us to try the hearing and retelling the biblical story. And I need someone to read a passage of scripture for me. Someone have a Bible and would be willing to read? Oh, I have a Bible. Okay. The scripture is the Samaritan woman at the well, John 4, verses 1 through 30, and then 39 through 42. And this is what I'd like to do. I'd like for Donna to read it, and then I'm going to invite you to hear a contemporary, to see and hear a contemporary interpretation. And I have to admit, I give credit to my students for this contemporary YouTube, because they used it in their final presentation, and I thought, oh, what a great idea. And so so we're going to have an opportunity to see that. And then I'd like for a male voice to read just the first part of that passage of scripture. So basically what we do, this is where the students will hear the passage more than once. So they hear it read once, then they're going to hear it a second time, and then hear it a third time, and then I'm going to toss the ball, and when the ball comes into your hands, you have to retell the story. Okay? Hold on just 1 minute. I'm still learning how to go back and forth. And verses 39 through 42.
John 4, verses 1 through 30.
John 4, verses 1 through 30. I'm just like, how did I get roped up in this?
Oh, yeah.
When therefore,
yeah.
American Standard Bible. When therefore the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself was not baptizing, but his disciples were, he left Judea and departed again into Galilee. And he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a city of Samaria called Sychar, near the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. And Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, was sitting thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. There came a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said, "Therefore," said to him, how is it that you, being a Jew, ask me for a drink, since I am a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Jesus asked and said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you the living water. She said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? You are not greater than our father Jacob, are you, who gave us the well and drank of it himself, and his sons, and his cattle? Jesus answered and said to her, everyone who drinks of this water shall thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give them, excuse me, shall never thirst. But the water that I give him shall become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water, so I will not be thirsty, nor come all the way over here to draw. He said to her, go, call your husband and come here. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, no, you have five. You have well said, I have no husband, for you who have had five husbands, and the one whom you have now is not your husband. This is you, this you have said truly. The woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and you people, say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, an hour is coming when neither in this mountain nor in Jerusalem shall you worship the Father. You worship that which you do not know. We worship that which we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But an hour is coming, and now is when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and truth. For such people the Father seeks to be his worshipers. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know that the Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When that one comes, he will declare all things to us. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. At this point, his disciples came, and they marveled that he had been speaking with a woman. Yet no one said, what do you seek, or why do you speak with her? So the woman left her water pot and went into the city and said to the men, come see a man who told me all the things that I have done. This is not the Christ, is it? They went out of the city and were coming to him. In the meanwhile, the disciples were requesting him, saying, Rabbi, eat. But he said to them, I have food to eat that you do not know about. The disciples therefore saying to one another, no one brought him anything to eat. Did he? Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. I'm going to skip down to 39 now.
Oh, actually, that's good.
Okay, all right, great.
That's
perfect.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you, Donna. In the interest of time, we won't have the third reading, but I would like to share this interpretation with you.
I am a woman. Of no distinction, of little importance. I am a woman of no reputation save that which is bad. You whisper as I pass by and cast judgmental glances, though you don't really take the time to look at me or even get to know me, for to be known is to be loved, and to be loved is to be known, and otherwise what's the point in doing either one of them in the first place? I want to be known. I want someone to look at my face and not just see two eyes, a nose, a mouth, and two ears, but to see all that I am and could be, all my hopes, loves, and fears. But that's too much to hope for, to wish for, or pray for, so I don't, not anymore. Now I keep to myself, and by that I mean the pain that keeps me in my own private jail, the pain that's brought me here at midday to this well. To ask for a drink is no big request, but to ask it of me, a woman unclean, ashamed, used and abused, an outcast, a failure, a disappointment, a sinner, no drink passing from these hands to your lips could ever be refreshing, only condemning, as I'm sure you condemn me now, but you don't. You're a man of no distinction, though of the utmost importance, a man with little reputation, at least so far. You whisper and tell me to my face what all those glances have been about, and you take the time to really look at me. But don't need to get to know me, for to be known is to be loved, and to be loved is to be known. And you know me. You actually know me. All of me and everything about me. Every thought inside and hair on top of my head. Every hurt stored up, every hope, every dread. My past and my future, all I am and could be. You tell me everything. You tell me about me. And that which is spoken by another would bring hate and condemnation. Coming from you brings love, grace, mercy, hope, and salvation. I've heard of one to come who would save a wretch like me, and here in my presence you say, I am he. To be known is to be loved, and to be loved is to be known. And I just met you, but I love you. I don't know you, but I want to get to. Let me run back to town. This is way too much for just me. There are others, brothers, sisters, lovers, haters, the good and the bad, sinners and saints, who should hear what you've told me, who should see what you've shown me, who should taste what you gave me, who should feel how you forgave me. For to be known is to be loved, and to be loved is to be known. And they all need this too. We all do need it for our own.
I thank my students for introducing me to that that YouTube. But what a wonderful way to draw upon the culture that attracts and embodies our youth. And so the idea of this exercise then, we'll just take a minute to do it.
Well, good morning, boys and girls. I'm really glad to be in your school today. We've got a fantastic story for you today. From the Bible.
The idea of the exercise then is everyone is sitting in a circle and you toss the ball to one person and retell the story. What do you remember about the story? Tell us a portion of the story. And then you could toss it to someone else who can tell another part of the story. Yeah, if you break us to the end. The end, absolutely. Your reflections on that experience, does this sound like an activity that might work with your youth? Or it might be helpful? Kinesthetic, yes. What else did you notice in terms of engaging the way students learn. Yes. Absolutely, yes, yes. It's a way for them to begin to interpret it themselves and to understand it themselves. And a way that you can add a twist to it is you can invite them to retell the story in a contemporary world. You know, if these were young kids in your high school, what might this story look like? And so that might be a different way that we could invite a retelling of the story. Any other? Yes. Right, yes. Anyone else want to respond before we move on? They can pass the ball. Pass it on to the next person. Yes. Very good. All right, thank you. We've got about 4 minutes left. let me just share with you the other ideas. And then we'll close with one last very easy, very short activity. Becoming a part of a story. And this is where I had some scripture cards, and you can make up your own scripture cards with different biblical characters. I have Nehemiah, Jeremiah, David, Ruth, Joshua, Deborah, and invite the young people to look at the stories, to read through the scriptures, and then to figure out who they identify with and why, and then begin to look at what were some of the challenges that this person faced and how did they overcome them. What kind of leadership skills did they embody and what might you learn from them? So that's one way that you can invite them to become a part of the story. And in a very similar way, they can explore biblical models of leadership. And again, it would be people like Moses and Abraham, Deborah, who were leaders. And this time, as they look at the scripture, they're looking at what were their characteristics as leaders? What allowed them to be leaders? And what might they learn as they begin to grow and to mature into leadership roles in their own communities? Also looking at the biblical models of leadership can also be used to do a biography or to do a timeline as well of these particular characters. You can develop litanies from the Psalms or from a long passage of scripture, and that's what we're going to do for our closing, is the litany that I've created from Psalm 103. And the advantage of creating a litany is that if you have a long passage of scripture that you want the students to look at, you have everybody involved in reading it at various times. It's a good way for you to get through it, for one thing, but then you can then go back and analyze each one of the different verses, the different aspects of it. It can be a part of worship or it can be a part of study. And you can also take the Psalms and turn them into a Lectio Divina, and I've taken a number of them and used them where I invite everyone to read in unison. And then we read responsively. And then we have one person who reads the scripture. And then they read it silently. And then as they settle on one passage, one verse that speaks to them, they sit in silence and meditate on that verse. And when they're invited, I invite them to pray that verse. And it can be in any order. And that's a really wonderful way to invite them into worship. And then, of course, the usual dance, drama, art, music with Bible stories are also ways that we can be involved. So I'd like to close, and I do have some handouts. So once we close, we'll make sure that you get all of the handouts. And if you have any questions, I'll be hanging around, and you can come up and ask me. I also wanted to acknowledge before we close that our president-elect, or our vice president of the Religious Education Association, Dr. Bud Harrell, is also here. And I'm thrilled that he and his wife were able to join us this afternoon. Wave your hand, Bud. Yay. Okay. Everyone just grab one. And I'm going to ask for volunteers to read. So whoever feels comfortable, I'm going to need. And just pass them on around. Okay, so this side of Jared is group one. You guys are group one. This side is group two. I need five readers. Who would be one? Number one. Number two. Someone number two. Number two. Number three. Four. I need a male voice. Male four. Yes. And five. Yes. Five. Okay. So group one, two, and then all. And then the rest is on the back. Okay. So I'm going to invite us all to stand. And I know we haven't had time to rehearse it, but read loud and proud and shouting loud. So, group one, let's begin. Praise the Lord, my soul, all my being. Praise God's holy name.
Praise the Lord, my soul, and do not forget how kind God is.
The Lord judges in favor of the oppressed and gives them their rights.
The Lord revealed God's plans to Moses and let the people of Israel see God's mighty deeds.
The Lord is merciful and loving, slow to become angry, and full of constant love. God does not keep on rebuking. God is not angry forever.
God does not punish us as we deserve, or repay us according to our sins and wrongs.
As high as the sky is above the earth,
so great is God's love for those who honor God. As far as the east is from the west,
so far does God remove our sins from us.
As the Father is kind to his children,
so the Lord is kind to those who honor God. God knows what we are made of. God remembers that we are dust. As of us, our life is like grass. But for those who honor the Lord, God's love lasts forever, and God's goodness endures for all generations of those who are true to God's covenant and who faithfully obey God's commands. The Lord placed God's throne in heaven. God is king over all.
Praise the Lord, he's strong and mighty angels, who obey God's commands, who listen to what God says. Praise the Lord, all you heavenly powers, you servants of the Lord, who do God's will.
Praise the Lord, all God's creatures, in all the places God rules. Praise the Lord,
my soul.
You may be seated. We didn't have a chance to use the candy on the index card, and I'll just tell you what that was about. Sometimes it's hard to get kids to go into groups, and so every now and then you can get a variety of different types of candy. And so if you want them to break up into four groups, all the Mr. Good Bars get together, and all the Crackles get together, and all of the dark chocolates get together, and all of the milk chocolates. And that's one way of doing it and getting them out from under their best buddy that they might be sitting under. And the index cards can be used in the same way. We broke up into groups in my class this last semester, and we used the cards, and everyone was going, team yellow, and team green is over here, and team purple is over there. So that's just a creative way, a different way of getting them into groups rather than always counting. And so with that, I thank you for the opportunity to share with you.
Thank you, Yolanda. Thank you for that wonderful presentation, which was really an advertisement for her seminar, which she will be teaching with Professor Almeida Wright, June 2 to 6. If you race home before anyone else gets there and register, you'll be in for an extraordinary symposium this summer, June 2nd to 6. Also, we have for you as you leave, if you'd like, the next copy of Yale's Theological Reflections Journal is dedicated entirely to youth. So we have copies for everyone here. As you go, please take a copy of the journal with us. Thank you for what you do with God's children. May God continue to bless you in your ministries. Next year, we will again gather on Wednesdays. Evelyn Parker will lead us off with the first program in October. Will be the elephant in the room, the question of race in churches. Dr. Ann Streety Wimberly will be the final presentation of the year. Tony Jones has already committed, a number of other great scholars. See you next year, if not at the symposium, June 2 to 6. Thank you very much.